Is up, guys. It's Avon coming at you from Queens, New York.
I'm Billy Bombs, and we are Mutant Metal Maniacs. And this is, we are so tired. We went out drinking all night.
Didn't fucking sleep much.
The bodega ball was amazing last night.
Yeah,
we're missing the second night to record you this episode because we're not going to know who's crowned Miss Drag Queen Bodega Ball this weekend. But Chai, what a great show. It was the main event.
Yeah, of
but
course.
Tonight's episode, we're going to talk about one of the best bands in the world.
Ever, man.
The Cro-Mags.
Fucking Cro-Mags, man. What can we say about the Cro-Mags, man? I mean,
that's the most awkward thing to say.
Bro, that hasn't already been
this
said.
This is like the crossover band that, like, if you listen to them and you've seen them live, like, because they're a little bit older than us, but when we were 13, they did a reunion show.
That was at the World.
Oh, yeah, that was on our... like best live experiences I saw them with Sick of It All and Blood for Blood. But this is such a good show. This is such a good record. But this band got a lot of history, man. And starting with this one, this was like there's a couple of crossover bands back in the day, like DRI and Leeway, which Abe's wearing sporting a new tight ass shirt.
Yeah, bro, looking fucking tight, bro.
Matching with his Boss Rootin' Hot.
Yes.
But
yeah.
I froze. From drinking.
Anyways, yeah, so, I mean, when I was a kid, I listened to this fucking record about 100 fucking million times. Not the record, but the CD or in some kind of fucking digital fucking media that I somehow would find. So this was one of, like, those crossover bands that wasn't all, like, punk rock. Like, I grew up a metalhead, right? So,
like, the lyrics are pretty punk rock because...
Yeah.
Well, let's go into the history of it.
Yeah.
Because they're a New York band. We've actually run into a bunch of the members through the years. And we even, this band is, like, legendary for their feud between Harley Flanagan and John Joseph. Man. Which we'll get into later. But when they started off, it was Harley Flanagan and this guy named Eric Casanova, who we used to see at Lorimer a lot on the L Train. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen that guy in a long time, but, like, he wrote a lot of the original songs, from what I know, and Harley wrote the music, but, like, I think Hard Times and, like, some of the more simpler songs, because then when you hear, like, Malfunction and Secrets of the Truth, that's all John Joseph's lyrics, and it's all his, like, wild, like
crazy Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna poetry.
Yeah.
Like, I love that band.
Man. I mean, they're cool because, you know, they were one of those bands, like Discharge, that it was like fucking thrash, but it was punk rock still. The same thing with Sheer Terror. Like, Sheer Terror wasn't that wasn't a pure hardcore band. Because what I'm saying is, like, the Cro-Mags were part of the beginning of that whole fucking thing. And then you had Agnostic Front that had Not One Voice. It was with the Eliminator, because that was fucking metal, man.
Yeah, that's a Cause for Alarm.
Yeah, Cause for Alarm.
Yesterday was actually the anniversary of Peter Steele's passing.
Oh, man.
Because he wrote, I think, most of or all of Cause for Alarm.
Yeah, a good portion of it.
That's we're gonna do an episode on itself because we love that band too.
Oh yeah, man.
I fucking love Agnostic Front.
Yeah, but not to get too fucking off the top.
Yeah, so the Cro-Mags. Like we said, they're legendary for their feud, and they came, and then the first album has John Joseph singing, and then the second album, which I have framed on my wall, and I had to take it down for this as well with the other one, is Best Wishes.
Yeah, that album I unfortunately did not get into until, like, not that long ago, because I was a teenager, and I was just like, oh, it doesn't have John Joseph in it, because, you know how it is, you get the fucking classic record, and then... As soon as the original singer changes, specifically, not like, you know, the guitarist, people usually don't give a shit, but like the singer who's the front man, like the face of the band, is not in the band anymore, and then you're like, I'm not really going to listen to it. It's like the same thing with a lot of dickheads that don't listen to the first two Iron Maiden records. Like, Paul Di'Anno's the fucking man, but I never listened to those two until, like, I was just stopped being a fucking dickhead and found out that those are two of the best fucking Maiden records. But, like, this is sort of the same thing. Except, well, reverse.
He wrote the first album. The second album is just Harley singing. Mm-hmm. And it's like a 4-piece band. Mm-hmm. And then there's a third album, which, if you ask anybody, they have no idea what it is. Like, you know, honestly, I have a flag of the Age of Quarrel in my bedroom, and it's huge. I wanted the Best Wishes one too, but it sold out. But, I have no idea what that is. And I love this band. I wear that shirt in all of our videos.
Yeah, and that's fucking most people. Most people, I think, only know the first two records. Both of them are really fucking good.
But all right, so when we were teenagers, everybody used to talk about their feud. But you'd always see John Joseph because we used to hang out on St. Mark's Place. And he's a real friendly Hare Krishna type of guy. Like, hey, what's up? How you doing? But all the older hardcore guys. Yeah, he's real positive. He's real PMA, positive mental attitude. But everybody was like, always avoid Harley. And they were like, that dude is nuts. Mm. And then I met him on St. Mark's Place. I'm 13 wearing my that same shirt, actually, because that one Abe gave me, we bought it together when we were kids. He gave me his, and I destroyed my first one. I destroyed that one, too. But, and he was mad cool, because we saw him right before his band Harley's War played at Seabees. And I didn't get a chance to see him because our friend Adam, his band Model Citizen, they opened up that show. And I don't remember why I didn't go in.
I actually didn't know that they opened.
Yeah, it was a really good show. CBs used to have some great shows, but you know what I mean? That's a different generation, though, than us. You know what I mean? CBGs. We were towards the end when it,
we were at the end. I mean, we got to
when
see
we get, it. When we started going to shows, I started going to shows in 1997 at Coney Island High, and I was 13.
Yeah, I came out after Coney Island High was already closed. Yeah. At least when I got into hardcore, you know what I mean? Yeah. I didn't fucking get to see any of that. I mean, I did. We did I did the CBGB's matinees. They were still doing it.
I went to a bunch of those. I love those. I love the punk shows. Hardcore shows always blew me away. I used to like going to beatdown ones. But anyway,
I used to love that stuff.
We digress. But the Cro-Mags was a real special band because I don't know anybody who did not like their first two records or always wanted a reunion show. And then I think in 2000 something. They did it. They actually made a reunion show, and it's actually my best live experience I talked about. And it's amazing. I still get goosebumps when We Gotta Know comes on, just that intro. Actually makes me feel it makes me nervous when it plays. I know all the lyrics to everything afterwards. It's just something about that intro is very metal and...
Doom is coming. But that's the thing with them. I was always a fucking metalhead when I was... I still am. But so the hardcore bands that were more punky, I wasn't as into. So when I started hearing Cause for Alarm and fucking and all these other bands, Sheer Terror, who the fucking guitarist Blake was a huge fan of Celtic Frost, so that's why the fucking first record kind of sounds like Celtic Frost. It's fucking weird. But they were a hardcore band. The same thing with the Cro-Mags. It was thrash. It's like you say, crossover thrash, and you don't hear fucking anything like that. And Cro-Mags is another one of those bands that you listen to it and you know it's fucking Cro-Mags. Maybe Best Wishes, you could say it sounds like an other bands, but that first Age of Quarrel,
Wishes is really good.
Best Wishes is amazing.
I don't give a shit, man. Crush the Demonic.
In terms of you being recognizing the music, the first record, it's that shit's fucking John Joseph. There's nobody that sounds like that. You know what I mean?
And then he does that shake when he's on stage when you're feels the fucking and you're holy shit, this guy really loves his music.
Dude, that's the thing is you the thing with Cro-Mags, you can go from listening to Cro-Mags to listening to Megadeth from that fucking same period and all the other fucking
In the day they used to open up for Megadeth and Motorhead and they had great shows and Motorhead and them really clicked. And here's the cool part is that they years later after all their drama and all their stuff start writing books and talking about it. And we'll start with the first one that came out a few years ago. And I'm having a brain fart what year it came out, but this book is awesome.
4 years ago, something like that, maybe more.
Nah, 2017, buddy. I was in college when this came out.
2017? When you were
I was 24,
college?
I'm 32. That's 20? 8 years ago. Oh, 2009.
Man. Okay.
Actually, this was so cool. This got me into the whole... let me go into detail. This talks about John Joseph's life growing up in New York City. And he talks about the Irish Riviera, known as Far Rockaway, and which I thought was amazing. It is the most, it is very, this and the other book we're going to show has something that they call, they don't really show these guys in the, a lot of people when they write their autobiographies always put themselves in a higher light. These guys don't. They put themselves in there I've been through a lot of shit. This is my life. I'm being honest with you. I want to tell you the truth because they're from New York. And when you're from New York, you tell the truth because... We can't lie for shit. We can't keep up a lie unless every hustle's short term. Every bullshit artist is a fucking is always hopping around, but like in but if you're from New York, you can't. It's hard. It's better just tell the truth and just be done. And like I think all of us have that sensibility where we're like, I can't even bullshit nobody. Let me just say it how it is. And I forget somebody who owns a bookstore was telling me how it's a thing where they make you relatable that you're like they're down to earth. But in New York, we have no idols. When you see guys like Vinny Stigma walking around, you just say hi. Like he always busts our balls about the Mets. You know what I mean? Like that's our lives. You know what I mean? Like, hey, how you doing? Yeah. But like when you go other places, I guess there's like heroes and idols and all that stuff. It's not, man. It's like it's four dudes who go in a room and make music, and it's amazing. Yeah. You know what I mean? And Cro-Mags is definitely one of them. It's a five man band that's amazing. But this book, he talks about growing up in Queens. We're from Queens, so it's a real like relatable story.
Yeah.
But like he talks about growing up in the foster care system, far
going to get drugs across the street from Grover Cleveland,
which is my high school. and it was called the Turbines back in the day, and it kind of cracked me up. It was like books like this you don't get to read because he talks about New York history, like, but from a street level, all the insane shits him and Harley Flanagan used to do, him and other dudes that he knew growing up, and like it's really cool, like and how he got into hardcore. But then he talks a lot, and this book has a lot about Hare Krishna and hardcore and Hare Krishna, which for us is like Shelter and Shia Lude and all these bands. Yeah. But like this is for me the first dude for that. Like Cro-Mags had to be the first band to be like that. Yeah. Him and Harley were very like hardcore, like vegans and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Like I went to one of John's Joseph's open spoken words shows with this one over in Delancey, the bar that called the Delancey on Delancey. And it was like, oh, it's Hare Krishna food. He was mad awesome. He told me some stuff to help me for my college. Like, I was in college.
I was going to ask you about that, yeah.
I did a college speech about, like, Hare Krishna and hardcore. And I read the last two pages in this book to end my speech. And obviously I got an A because John Joseph can write a hell of a, like, autobiography. Yeah. And, like, it's very PMA, very positive. I'm hoping a second printing comes out or a third or a fourth or fifth.
So keep coming out. One.
I can only think of one. Because this is really good, like, and I've, like, it needs to come out more of them. Because, like, he tells a story, and in all honesty, for his feud with Harley Flanagan, he does not put him in a dark light at all. You know what I mean? Like, he, like, makes fun of him, but, like, that's New York life. You make fun, you gotta put out the stories that you think are fucking hilarious. But, like, it's not, like, in the light that, like, I kind of expected from hearing about it, like, the word on the street, all these people telling these tall tales, and like it's
fucking like fuck some it. Fucking kind of crazy good versus evil type of fucking shit. That shit is so outlandish that
it's fucking retarded. But then it's here's the thing. I'm talking about at the time when this book came out. Mm-hmm. But then years later, at CBGB's Fest. A
couple of months ago.
No, this is a couple months ago. This is like 2 years ago.
This book?
No, this book came out a couple months ago, but 2 years ago. There was a fight at CBGB's Fest.
Oh, that shit.
And Harley finally got in the news for getting arrested for stabbing somebody at the show. And he finally... And, like, I've been waiting years for this. I've been waiting since 2009 for Harley Flanagan's book to come out.
Yeah.
And this is awesome as well. He's very relatable. He talks about life growing up in the Lower East Side. There is no glamorous stories about himself in this at all. Cool. My favorite story is him chasing down Hatebreed. Because he talks about all of them being 5'6". I'm 5'6", and I kind of get it. He's a maniac. And, like, but his stories never shine him in a good light. It's, like, relatable. Like, he talks about, like, finding himself, telling the story. He tells the story of him and John Joseph. And even then, up until the end with the CBGB's Fest, there is no, like, ill will, like, in these stories. You know what I mean? Like...
Yeah.
Like, whatever, it feels like people are just telling their side of a, like, a tall tale that they've been, that we've all heard that, but we finally had to hear the truth about it from both of them.
That's
John Joseph's side, and now this, and then Harley's side. I love this book, because the thing with this, John Joseph I related to as a kid from Queens. This one I related to is knowing my dad. And, like, that's kind of weird to say, because my dad grew up on the streets, and he's a maniac in his own right. But this guy, like, his story talking about this stuff, him and my dad are the same age. So, like, roughly the same age. And I'm, like, completely amazed at, like, how, like, New York life is. And, like, how... It's just insane. You know what I mean? You're lucky to survive. So, survival of the streets, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
It's like... It, and if you get a chance to... This one, I think, is on its 12th printing. And people are buying these, like, fucking hotcakes.
That shit fucking sold out so fast.
Yeah, I got this at Barnes & Noble's.
Yeah.
And I remember seeing a stack of them, and then they told me that was, like, the second run they ordered. And that's in Manhattan, where nobody goes to a section of Manhattan like BMCC College that nobody's ever fucking at. So you know people are hunting this down. And if you get a chance to pick this up, pick up both books and read them. You really, this is a good indication, I mean, a history of New York hardcore from different perspectives. He does not talk about bands like how other people talk about bands, how great they are. He usually calls them out for being shitty. And, like,
does he talk about,
like... Oh, man, one dude, like, he calls him the biggest coward that he has ever met in his life, and I think I almost pissed myself laughing. Oh, because there's very, like I said, like, we're used to people telling the truth. You know what I mean? Like, you gotta, like... Because everybody's going to challenge you. In New York, everybody's going to challenge you. We walk around with New York face all day long. Yeah. And we were talking to a cabbie the other night, and he was telling us, like, he's from South Carolina. And he's like, everybody's so mean. I just asked the guy, where do you get his haircut? And he was like, what the fuck are you talking to me?
Yep.
And that's New York face, that's man.
Right.
That's like, right. Like, the second time I ever saw Harley, like, I saw him walking down the street. Like, we don't see these guys much except when they're playing. Like, because he's somebody's dad now, you know. He's two guys' dad. He's two kids' fucking, dads.
They're you know, they're older guys than us, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so...
And he's actually an instructor in jiu-jitsu, which is, like, fucking can tell you awesome. How much that can make your life great. He's been doing it for, like, a long time now.
I think he just got his black belt not too long ago.
Yeah, but how long did he teach him? Like, 10 years?
A long time, man.
And, like, he tells his side of the story of that news article. And I don't know if anybody else is going to come out with a book, because there's a third member in this band that's always, like, brought up in Paris. And he's a camera operator, like, who makes a shit ton of money because he just wants to make movies. Mm. Like, from what I know, he does interviews with French magazines, but he's not doing anything with New York companies or nothing like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But, like, this guy's still making records, and his records are really good. John Joseph also was writing his own records. Like, there's Alpha Omega. I think, what's another band that he's got?
Dude, I don't know. I don't know about any of that stuff.
Like,
all the extra stuff on the side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, because Harley's always been, like, White Devil or Harley's War, or now he owns the rights to the name Cro-Mags, so he tours on the Cro-Mags.
Yeah.
What else, man? What else? Because, like, the thing is, I was trying to remember all the names of the bands that people do. Like, I want to say When Worlds Collide, but it's something similar to that, but, like, I can't remember. But, like,
dude, that's just too much.
A World's Apart, I think it was called.
That's a lot, you know?
Yeah. But, like, a lot of the hardcore bands do different stuff. I prefer if they stick to the name that they started out with. It makes it easier to find the awesome music they do.
Oh, stop. I know. I mean, yeah, dude. I mean, I haven't fucking read them, so I can't.
Ames is still in the plastic from 2009.
Mine is indeed still in the plastic. Yeah, yeah.
Two books that you got to add to your hardcore collection.
I have too many fucking
books. From two dudes who this is like the tale of Paul Bunyan, these two guys.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, you had, like, I died to read them both, and I read them, like hardcore, man. I did a review on Amazon, I forgot, I left it anonymous, so if you see it.
Really? You had to do that? What? You had to do that? I read them hardcore.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I didn't, like,
fucking
You know why? Because it says on the back.
Fucking, oh, God, my head hurts.
No, it doesn't. That's good for drinking. No, dude, but, like, this is an excellent book. Evolution of Cro-Magnon, and, like, they're relatable. If you can read them, you can relate to them. Like, yeah, I said, John Joseph's book, I read it. I related to it when I was in college and growing up. And, like, you don't always spend the same time with the same people. You don't ever see people twice. And sometimes you see people that wronged you as a child. And you want to get revenge on them and you grow out of it. And, like, John Joseph definitely did. And you know what? He's a great man for it. Harley Flanagan's more of a tale of, like, like some real hard times. And, like, how, like, you could screw up and come home, but you guys, like, New York still has those dudes who always challenge you, who's the bigger dog. And, like, this dude is not a big dude, but this dude, like, is a fucking wrecking ball.
Fucking wrecking machine.
Like, he even says it best when he was attacking the truck with Avery and in the story. He was like, I was like, at that moment, I was fucking Godzilla. I fucking died. But if you get a chance to read them both. Pick up both albums, the first two albums.
First two records.
Harley of War, all records. Of them are good.
Fuck, yeah. Just do yourself a favor and get all of it. I mean, I don't know about any, like, after the first record. I mean, the first two, you know, that are actually Cro-Mags.
I think it's Alpha Omega's.
I think you're right. Yeah, you're right.
But I was like, I'm good. Because there's too much weird writing. I think I have it on cassette.
But, I mean, yeah, like, listen to those fucking records. Should pick up the fucking books, which I still fucking have to read, too, so let me stop talking shit.
Find it, buy it,
yeah, quickly. You know, I hopefully in the future I'd like to fucking review these records, because I mean, I've Age of Quarrel, I've listened to God knows how many times. Best Wishes, I have not listened to that many times. So I want to make a run through that.
Like, once you hear that, the beginning part. Because both albums have this great intros. Yeah. Just Cro-Mags, Age of Quarrel, feels like doom's coming. When you see
it's crushing good fucking music, man.
Yeah, and then Crush the Demonic is the beginning of Best Wishes. And you just hear it, dan, 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 but it starts with the fucking drums, like, dan, 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 and you're like, oh, man, this is going to be good.
Dude, and then the fucking end of Age of Quarrel, man, that fucking...
Oh, Hard Times is such a great song.
No,
not Hard Times, Sign of the Times.
Sign of the Times.
These are the Sign of the Times.
It's got to be, like, top five favorite fucking songs I have. Oh, my God, it's so fucking good. It's just like... The fucking lyrics tell you exactly where the record is from. Like, you can tell that it was like mid fucking 80s, and this, if AIDS don't get you, then the Warheads will.
That's a great line.
Fucking even like that's so badass.
And other recommendations on YouTube, there's a video that I used to have on VHS as a kid called In Effect 91 that has a couple of shows. It's Cro-Mags. It's Gorilla Biscuits, Sick of It All, and Elastic Front live at the Ritz. And in between is interviews with Jimmy Gestapo and Harley Flanagan in it. Has stories of that's a good part about this book is all the stories of him growing up with hardcore guys that we looked up to. And, you know, you love, like, Murphy's Law is an amazing band. He talks about growing up with Vinny Stigma and seeing him ride his bike. Ray from Warzone, who in other videos, like, I fucking love that band more than anything.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's awesome, but, like, if you get a chance, watch the documentary. We're always supportive of other people's videos, and check it out. It's the whole thing. It's, like, an hour and a half, and the songs are great. Like, I never even got into Gorilla Biscuits until I saw their VHS, and they're an awesome fucking band. Listen to them. Watch that video, the interview with Paris and Harley, and then there's one of the dudes, I think, from... Fuck, I think, I forget, so a metal band is on there too, so it's kind of cracking up because they talk about the crossover. And if you look, my big thing is that I'm watching the video and you see live and you see the guys from Biohazard like running around, and you're like, I love Biohazard.
Yeah.
But like, check out that video. We're going to put up more stuff every week, more hardcore stuff. We're going to focus more on the stuff we love, which is hardcore, comic books, movies. Everything we can, but, like, this is something that, we're not experts in, but we love more than anything else.
Oh, yeah, man. Part of our lives, man.
Yeah, like, it's a hardcore vein in our life, man. That's the only way to describe it. It's, like, it's got a big part. Because in the end, there's people that are, like, there's subcultures within subcultures. And the awesome part is, like, if somebody ever asks you what you're into, there's people who are, like, I'm a street punk, I'm a metalhead, I'm a thrash kid, I'm this. We're just... hardcore kids from Queens, and fucking from Queens to Japan, they know what the fuck that means.
Yeah, that's right.
So EGH said it best. All right, so we're signing off. I'm Billy Bombs.
I'm Yves Von Doom.
And this was our latest episode. So thank you.
Don't forget to like and subscribe.
Oh, yeah.